Hi, my name is Jacqui-Lee Pryce and welcome to Shadowboxing.
Hi and welcome to Champ Tunes and Chats. I have a special guest today, Jonathan Kumuteo. And the third person in the ring is...
DJ Sai.
So hiya, Jonathan, how you doing?
I'm fine, thank you. And yourself?
Yeah, I'm not bad. I cannot complain. So how's lockdown been treating you?
Lockdown has been, you know what, somewhat okay. It's been nice to be able to relax, let my body rest alongside my mind. And that's something for me I haven't been able to do for a few years, you know, trying to get back up on my feet, trying to sort out my pro contract, trying to sort this out, trying to sort that out. So in a sense, everything I need to do is done. So I'm just using this time to chill and just embrace it really and truly.
So you've mentioned it already. So firstly, congratulations. New promotions team, I should say. You've just signed with Frank Warren. Brilliant news.
Thank you.
So talk about that for a second. You obviously were in the amateur scene. You've just turned over. We'll talk about the amateur scene in a bit, but you've just signed with Frank Warren. So in terms of any dates or anything, I know we're on lockdown, but have you been given any dates yet? Has there been any discussions around you getting out there in 2020?
It was quite weird, actually, because I was actually meant to debut in April on a show live on BT Sport. However, we didn't even get an opportunity to announce the show because there were rumours that the board was going to cancel all pro boxing events. And then a couple of weeks later, Boris Johnson went and announced the lockdown. So that's now postponed indefinitely. But I wouldn't say we've got a new date just yet. We're just trying to wait until the board come up with something. I believe they're having a meeting at the end of this month. And then within a few weeks, hopefully within the next 4 to 8 weeks, I'll know when I'll be boxing. But I believe it'll be sometime later in the year, maybe around August, September, October. But regardless, I'll stay ready.
So, yeah, what's interesting is you've thrown your name into the hat of some of the great welterweights. You've got Chris Congo, Johnny Garton, Chris Jenkins. I mean, you're coming into a really nice group of people. But I think most of those are partly Warren's camp, aren't they?
Not really. Chris isn't. I sparred with Chris. I sparred with a few others. I believe Johnny Garton is on this side. But he's on the latter stages of his career, right? And there's a few others. I'm not really into naming names, but the welterweight scene or the domestic scene is quite packed with talent, to say the least.
So how is that going to work, though? Because I do know that Chris Jenkins definitely is with Frank Warren. I think Echo Essuman is another one. So how does that work in terms of you kind of all trying to vie for the same things? How does that work?
In my opinion, how can I say it? I'm only focused on myself. I don't care about anybody else. So maybe that's a question for you to ask them. But as far as I'm concerned, I'm only focused on me, myself, and I. You know, I'm at the beginning of this professional boxing journey. And, you know, my course, my only competition, my only opponent is the man in the mirror. So I'm not paying attention to them. It's great to have them as stable mates. Some of the others, they're good fighters, but I don't really care.
Fair enough. So let's have your first track. What's the name? Who's it by? And why have you picked it?
Yep. So the first track is called Saucy by T. Dines. I like this track because it means something to me. It's like, there's just something about the song that just, there's so much about the song. In fact, it's been my favorite song for a few years now. And when the professional debut happens, hopefully we might have a live performance from the man himself, T. Dines. Wake up in the morning, flex. Put my slugs in and then I flex. I put gold chains around my neck.
And when my watch hit my wrist, I know it's time to get a check. Got it straight off the block, Balboa running up the steps. She can tell I'm from the west, see it from the way I dress. Underrated jeans with a fitted tee, I probably mess it with a creps. Working hard, I need a rest. It came in short, I need a rest. Boy, I'm trying to make a rest. Bitch, get that shit a rest.
Nice track. So, you're talking about that he may be coming and performing at your debut. How is that going to work with regard to the special measures that they're putting in place?
I'm not too sure. There's actually a lot to think about it, because it's almost like he's going to perform in front of nobody. But then everybody will be watching from TV. So it will be interesting to see. And hopefully if I get given a green light to have my plus one, which will have to be TDNS, so he can perform the song for me, that will be very, very cool.
I like the fact that you've just said, my plus one, and it has to be him, so that no one else asks you for that plus one. Nice. So let's talk about your background. You're from the Congo, aren't you?
Yeah. I was born in Congo. At the time, it was Zaire, 1995, November the 5th. And there was a civil war at the time. So we moved away from Congo in 2000. And I actually spent 2 years in Zambia prior to coming to the UK in 2003, age seven.
So you actually got, we've got something in common actually. You were shipped off to England when you were seven, and I was shipped off to Trinidad when I was six. So we've got that in common.
Okay. There's a big age difference between myself and my sisters. So I've got three siblings, age 10, 12 and 14.
Yeah.
And I'm 24. But my one was a little bit different, because one morning, or late night, early morning, my mom woke me up. She said, you're going to London to live with your dad. And she put me on a plane, age seven, to travel over 7,000 miles on my own. So that's my story.
But what was it like in terms of just, you know, you get here, I'm presuming you couldn't speak the language, and you go to school. What was that like in terms of the difference between a British school and schools at home?
Yeah, so for me, the biggest difference was actually, first of all, I did speak English, but my first language was French. My second language was Swahili. My third language was English. My fourth language was Nyanja. My fifth was Bemba, the two national languages of Zambia.
I like the way you just put me in my place there.
So, prior to coming to the UK, I believe my parents knew I was going to come. So they sent me to an English-only school. So it was, what was the main difference was that in school, they used to literally hit us if we didn't speak English. So if we spoke any other language than English, we'd be in trouble. And so, yeah, I guess by force, I knew how to speak English before I came. And I don't ever remember being fresh or having an African accent, but I must have.
Yeah. It's difficult, isn't it, when you're a child and you have to sort of leave everything you know and then make new friends and all of that stuff. It's quite difficult. So then you started, obviously...
In my opinion, it just happened so fast. It happened so fast. It couldn't even materialize in my mind, if that makes sense. You know, one morning I was in Africa, but the next day I was in the UK. What probably struck me the most was just seeing snow for the first time. That day, I'll never forget.
So you joined a boxing club, I think it was 12 years of age, was it? You joined Finchley ABC?
No, it was at 15 in 2011. I joined Finchley ABC and I didn't even want to box before that. I just went because a friend of mine kept on asking me to spar him down at the boxing gym. I went and I fell in love with the sport instantly.
Yeah. And then you've got old Sean Murphy there as well.
Yeah, Sean Murphy, he's one of my inspirations. He's my amateur boxing coach. You know, he's still an advisor of mine. He's still someone that I reach out to all the time. And he's still someone that I will train with every now and then.
Yeah, he's a good man. And he's done a lot for amateur boxing as well. Very, very good man.
Honestly, a lot. And he was a great professional boxer himself, you know.
Amen.
As an amateur, winning gold at the Commonwealth Games, winning the British title outright. I believe he was a three-time British champion. So, yeah, he's got accolades himself.
Yeah. So just tell me what the name of your second tune is and why you've chosen it.
Okay, so my second tune is a song by Niska called Madeline, and it's a French song. I listen to quite a lot of French rap, and he's one of my favorite French artists. And if you hear the beat, you know, it's just, it's like you can zone out to the song, just listen to it, and you can prepare and do what you need to do. If that makes sense. Je suis violent comme sud de l'Italie, mafieux comme les trapatonis, si figure de la paix, j'ai compté du pif, j'avais. Je suis violent comme sud de l'Italie, mafieux comme les trapatonis, si figure de la paix, j'ai compté du pif, j'avais pas lire. Qui lui a mis dans la tête, parce que son petit frère s'est fait salir. J't'ai pas fait du sale quand j'ai failli, mais devant les keufs, j'ai du taille. Talking about, you know, being at Finchley, being around Sean Murphy, who's a great guy. You know, you've got some great people that you've trained alongside. One being AJ. Good friends with AJ, I understand. Mm-hmm. Has he been helping you with your sort of journey into the professional scene? He helped me a lot. Even away from the sport, he helped me. Even just being growing up as a youngster, as a young adult, he's helped me so much. They've taught me so much. Him and his team, especially KD, David. But, you know, I was a sponge in the sense of being around them so much and I was soaking in information. But then I wasn't really applying it to myself. Mm-hmm. So then I had to take myself away from the situation, make myself the main character of my story and apply what I learned from them to myself.
That's great that you're actually now starting to use that information, because I was going to say also that it must have been such an amazing thing to be surrounded by great coaches, also an Olympian, and it sort of gives you a vision of where you want to be, I'm guessing.
100%. You know, to even see AJ's journey from before the Olympics to winning the Olympics to winning the British against Dylan White, the IBF against Charles Martin, to unify, to lose his title and bounce back, two-time heavyweight champion of the world. It's amazing. And I'll tell you one thing, AJ hasn't changed at all from before the Olympics to date.
That's a good thing to hear, because so many, not just in boxing, change and they kind of, I don't know, lose themselves in the fame. So that's really great to hear that he's still the same person. I've heard that along the way. So yeah, that is really good to hear. So let's talk about a little bit about your background in terms of your amateur career. So I know you've kind of covered it with a few people, but obviously my followers may not have heard the story that you were quite ill when you were an amateur boxer and you had a disease called HS. Could you talk to me a little bit about that?
Yep. So I had my first fight in October 2012. I won that. Fast forward a few years later, 2015, I fell ill suddenly with a skin disease called hidradenitis, or HS, also known as acne inversa. And what that does is it gives you, or you get a repeated abscesses and boils in your underarms, and it can affect other areas. But for me, it affected my underarms mainly. And I still boxed. I had three operations. After the first operation, I was out for about 6 weeks, got back in the gym, had more fights. Second operation happened January 2017. That one, I was very, very ill and I was weak for about 8 months. I still bounced back, came back, boxing the amateurs still. But this time I did it behind the scenes in terms of I jumped off social media because mentally I wasn't there. You know, I was very upset. And I felt as though I was playing catch up to the old version of myself, because in 2016, I won the London Novice Championships, lost in the national semis a few weeks later, was told to rest, and I couldn't get out of bed 2 weeks later because I was that ill. And I was ill throughout the whole summer training for the championships. But, you know, for me, when I realized that there was people out there going through what I'm going through, and winning with those situations, I stopped complaining. So I just got on and I did it. However, you have to draw the line somewhere. You know, if I wanted to pursue a pro boxing career, I really, really needed to chase up my doctors and rectify the situation, because I had open wounds in my underarm. Even though I was still boxing, still winning, sometimes losing close decisions, there was no way I was going to be a successful professional if I didn't rectify the situation. Luckily, I came across a fantastic surgeon at the Royal Free Hospital, Barbara Jemick and her team, and they operated on me. I had a skin graft operation. They took the donor skin from my bottom and literally removed my sweat glands in my underarms. So now I don't sweat and I'm fully recovered, fully healed, no medication, no pain, nothing. And I'm finally ready to make my pro boxing transition.
That is an inspirational story. Number one, how old were you when you were going through all of this?
So I'm 24 now. This was all pretty much between age 18 to 24. 18 to 23.
I mean, many people don't go through that in their lifetime. Not that I would wish that on anybody. But for you at such a young age, you know, how did you cope with the constant setbacks?
I'm not going to lie to you. It was not easy. It was difficult. And looking back now, I smile and I laugh because that's how I deal with things. But there was times when I just wanted to give up. I remember a date that strikes me was New Year's Eve 2016. Less than 8 weeks prior to that, I won the London Novice Championships and I couldn't even get out of bed. And I remember looking on social media, everyone was going out, enjoying themselves. And I was at home in bed and I said to myself, like, please, God, why me? You know, I literally couldn't do 5 star jumps. I was that weak and that in pain. And in the back of my mind, I knew I had to have another operation. I had that operation and I still wasn't recovered. That almost broke me, because I remember after my second operation, I went to the gym. I tried to rep 10 reps on a bench press without any weights and I couldn't do it. So I had to literally pick myself back up from scratch. But you know what? It strengthened me. It made me a lot stronger, not only physically, but also mentally. It showed who the true people were around me. And in a different way, it's preparing me for what's to come in this professional game.
100%. Do you feel that now you've been through something like this, nothing can phase you now?
Oh yeah, that's how I feel. Honestly, like, it's weird, but I feel invincible now, hand on my heart, because my doctor also said to me that I was performing at around 50% because I was on minimum eight tablets a day of strong antibiotics that people with TB and HIV took, and I was still competing and winning, right? So post-op with no illness, no medication, imagine what I'll be capable of now. Do you understand what I'm saying? So I'm just so excited. I can't wait to get in that ring to show myself, to show the people what I'm capable of.
So the third song, who's it by and why have you picked it?
Yep, so the third song is called Paper Cuts by an artist called Dave, or Santan Dave, some people know him as. He's one of the top UK artists. He's popping right now. I like this one because it gives you that energy. You know, to, if you're running, if you're in the gym, you're about to prepare for a fight, this is one of my songs I would play and it would definitely be giving me that little extra burst of energy.
It's incredible scenes. You can't make this up. 2 times that a man lost blood. Football and paper cuts. I see them man hating now. Fuck, why you gotta make it tough? Why fork or break that up? Trust, she can never make that us. Beef ain't mental. Me and bro in a bus down rental. Piss could have ride out unsuccessful. Wasted trip from Central. Should have invoiced my man for the petrol. That girl got shaped, that's dreadful. Pencil, body come thin like Red Bull. Young G on a rise, Kenzel. Trim a little nigga outlines like stencils.
I understand that you not only box, that you are also a motivational speaker. Talk to me about that.
I'd like to say so. How that came about was when I felt ill, I put out, well, when I had my third operation, I put out a video of when they removed my my dressings, and that went viral, literally viral. People still message me till this day. That was about, what, 17 months or so ago. And a lot of people urged me to take up public speaking because they said I motivated them. So, you know, at first, I was like, not really on it. Went and did it. 20 plus schools, over 10,000 students. Told them my story and hope to inspire them through sport and to encourage a growth mindset. And that was great. That was fantastic. And it gave me more purpose. And I feel as though we all know that the youth is the next generation. But now I'm also all about youth empowerment. And I want to continue as soon as these social distancing measures have been lowered or are no longer a problem. But it was amazing. It was honestly amazing. Every school, you know, whether it be in an independent school, special educational needs, secondary school, sixth form college, all the students were different, but they were all inspired by boxing. And I wished that somebody could have introduced me to boxing at a younger age. And I'm glad that I did. And a lot of the parents and teachers messaged me on Instagram, etc. And they say that their kids have taken up boxing and that I really, really meant something to them that day.
So, Jonathan, what would be your fourth choice? Name, artist, and why?
Yep, so the name of the song is called Bronson by an artist called Bugsy Malone. This one means a lot to me because it's quite a deep song, you know. This is one of those songs that I play, you know, when I'm driving home late night. And, you know, if you just listen to the story that he's telling, it's amazing. And it can be motivational. And he also did a lot of boxing himself and does a lot of boxing. So it's that much closer to home, if that makes sense. But it's one of those late night ride home songs.
Do the muscle, that dirty way before music. Got a little dirty, yeah, I'm not used it. Trying to separate myself from my body. But when I heard that, I was ready to lose it. But then I prayed to God because I swore down on my mom's life that I didn't want to do this. But she keeps ringing and asking, I told her, let's not go through this. Still, I'm thinking, where do we go from here? How did I go so clear? All of this in 1 year? I just want to kick back and spend this money. But I'm still wearing the tracksuit and I still go with the shooters. This is no new shit. I was going to clap.
I've been looking at your social media. You seem very savvy with that side of things. You seem very savvy with the business side of things. So just from a generational point of view, what are your thoughts on people posting sparring videos on social media?
It depends, you know. I think it depends on two parties, you know. Your sparring opponent, are they happy with you posting it? If they're not, then you really need to think about who they are to you and what they mean to you. Because, you know, some people may feel violated if you put out sparring. However, we definitely live in a generation where you can't be that boxer that, you know, have you heard of that guy? I think his name is JK. He's really good, but I've never really seen him. Now, it's all about, you know, unfortunately, we live in a generation where seeing is believing. So, if you're taking people to school and sparring and you're giving gym beatdowns, then that's what's going to make your social media grow. And that's what will, in a sense, make you more relevant because, you know, at the end of the day, it's a numbers game. And the likes of Devin Haney did that and his social media blew up because of the sparring. This was before he signed with who he signed to now. So, and then there's another guy, Ryan Garcia, who puts out a lot of clips on the speed bag. And that helped him blow up alongside the sparring clip. So I think it depends, but I think it definitely works. And I certainly do put up some sparring, but I wouldn't put up all my sparring.
Yeah, I mean, play devil's advocate. If someone dropped you in sparring, how would you feel? Yeah, seeing that all over social media.
All publicity is good publicity. That's how I see it, honestly. It can be difficult, but you know what? if you're not ready to take hate or criticism, then this game is not for you. And this game is not even a game, it's real life. So it comes with the territory. It comes with wanting to be a TV star. It comes with wanting to become a world champion and all these things. So you've got to take the good with the bad.
Okay. Yeah. I think it's nice that you're able to put it into perspective in terms of where you want to go and what you think is going to happen on that route in terms of, I don't like to use the word fame, but yeah, I think it's good that you've kind of thought of it that way. I think a lot of people are thinking of some people that post consistently on social media, every little thing. There's this line of thought that they are social media boxers rather than actual boxing talents. Would you agree or not?
Yes, I do agree to an extent, because there's actually a lot of fighters who always post boxing, right? Boxing, boxing, boxing. But they never fight. They never fight. They're just Instagram boxers. And I used to be that guy too, to an extent. But I took myself away from that, and I tried to use my social media platform for boxing, of course, but to for people to pay attention for not just boxing. And I wouldn't, and I don't even put out my sparring clips. I rarely even put up clips of me hitting the pads. But like I said, seeing is believing. Fortunately nowadays, if you don't put out your sparring clips, your training clips, people won't believe you. They won't believe that you're in the gym putting in work and fighting. It's sad, but it is what it is. It's a lot easier than back in the day, because now we've got the platform where we can put out whatever we want to put out. We don't have to necessarily pay for it, and the people will see.
So what would be your final track? What's the name and why have you chosen it?
Yep, so my final track is called Paid in Full. It is by two guys called Eric B and Rakim. It's an American old school track, old school hip hop. I believe it was in the 80s. And I like that song because it inspires me, it motivates me. Of course, it's about getting paid in full, making money. And it's also one of the main songs from one of my favorite films called Paid in Full, based on some hustlers from Harlem. And that film was very motivational to me. And even though they did the wrong things, it's what I got from the film was how to hustle and how to hustle hard and how to, in a sense, be different, even though you're doing the same thing as everybody else. So I tried to reapply that to my boxing, to my social media, to everything that I do. You know, you can pick and you can learn from anybody, whether they do something negative or not. Coming up the limp, thinking of a master plan. This ain't nothing but sweat inside my hands. So I dig, thinking of a master plan. This ain't nothing but sweat inside my hands. So I dig into my pocket, all my money spent. So I just default, but still coming up with lint. So I
love that track. I absolutely love that track. And it made me laugh because the way you sort of said, yeah, like it's, I don't know, back in the 80s or like it was like 100 years ago.
You know, because everyone listens to new school hip hop, and no one listens to that type of music. So if I play it now, people will think, "What the hell?"
Are you serious?
But it honestly means a lot. Yeah, hand on my heart.
But people don't listen to old school hip hop.
They do more Biggie and Tupac, but they wouldn't know who Eric B and Rakim are.
Wow!
And if they've heard of that song, they would have only heard of it because of the song, the film Paid in Full, in my opinion.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow. So it's one of those things like there's sometimes that I've played tracks in the gym and you expect the youngsters to know it and they're kind of like, what is this shit?
Yeah. Yeah, people don't, you know, is people follow more than they do study.
Mm-hmm.
So we live in a time when if someone notable or someone who they rate says something is cool, something is good, then they have their viewers have their approval before they themselves go away and listen to it. So that's the same for music, boxing, whatever it is. So now we live in a time when someone says something's cool, then it's cool. So if old school hip-hop isn't something that is cool, it's no longer in fashion, so people won't care until notable people start putting it out there again.
So I'm guessing that this lockdown period for most people has been not necessarily traumatic, but life-changing. Mm-hmm. With regard to yourself, I mean, what have you learned about yourself that you didn't already know?
It's like this. I was frustrated that the fight wasn't going to happen. But I was, you know, I very much understand that health is wealth and it's the number one thing, you know. And it did, and it took for me to have three operations to really understand it, truly understand it and value my health. And then the second thing was I suddenly had all this time where my contracts were out of the way. I was chilling, waiting for Frank Warren to make the announcement. So, you know, everything was done. Everything was in place. And I was relaxed, but after 3 weeks, I couldn't relax anymore. I was like, damn, I need to do something. I need to give myself a new task, a new aim and objective. And so for me, I've learned that I just don't chill. I've actually been very busy during this quarantine and I've given myself different tasks. I've still been training. So if anything, I've been just as busy and I haven't really learned anything new because I've been here before. Three times, you know, second time for 8 months, first time for 6 weeks, third time for 3 months. And the biggest difference is I couldn't move out of my bed before. Now I can go downstairs, get food, leave, go to the stores, go for a run, you know, train, go on social media, connect with new people. And these are some of the things that I was literally stripped away from having those operations. I remember my third operation, I couldn't even brush my teeth for 2 weeks. Do you know how hard it is to build that type of patience? You know, I had to go for the first 2 months. I literally, because the donor skin came from my bottom, I had to go to the bathroom once a week.
Wow.
It gives you, and you learn a new type of patience to a point where you're just saving yourself. Okay, if I go to the toilet now, I might end up back in hospital because you might get stuck on the toilet seat. That happened twice. The ambulance had to come get me from the bathroom. So in other words, long story short, I've already learned patience and now is just another time to reapply that same way of thinking.
Do you know what I was thinking? You've actually have learned something. You've learned to utilize the time that's given to you. So, okay, you had a little chill session, which is perfectly acceptable for 3 weeks. Then, like you said, you've set new goals for yourself. I think it's absolutely brilliant and inspirational, Jonathan, to be honest with you. Anybody looking at this can take so much from you. They can really take so much from you. One of the things I did want to ask you, it popped into my mind, was since you have been through such a health scare, were you one of those people that had to be extra careful with regard to the coronavirus?
Yes and no. Yes, because since I was ill, I became a hygiene freak. So, you know, always washing my hands and doing all these things way before quarantine. And no, because I'm fully healed and I don't like to think about the negative possibilities. So I just made sure, keep doing, I told myself, keep doing what you're doing, but be extra cautious. But I'm okay. Otherwise, I'm okay, you know. I wouldn't say I'm a vulnerable person in these times because I'm fit and healthy, but I definitely just reminded myself to just take a little more care.
Your story is not only fascinating, it's heartwarming, it's exciting. I'm really looking forward to seeing your progression in the pro game. Thank you very much for giving us your time.
You're welcome. And also, you know, you're talking about the story and you're talking about what I do on the social media, etc. Let's not divulge away from the main thing, and that's boxing. And when boxing returns, I will show the people that, you know, I'm just not good with the business side of things, but I can fight. For real. Do you understand where I'm coming from? But time will tell. Time always tells. So I'm chilling. I'm relaxed. But when it's time to fight, I will be ready.
If you like this video, please go ahead and give it a thumbs up. If you're not a subscriber of Shadowboxing UK, we'd love to see you, so please go ahead and subscribe now.